They are.
Audience.
So if you out there, you have an important role in our story, and that is to clap and cheer as loud as you can for all of our great volunteers, because for some of them, this might be their theatrical debut. And why today, this little knight here is defeating trolls at Knoebels, tomorrow he might be defeating trolls on Broadway, or even Hollywood. And he would give all of our actors and actresses the encouragement they need. So audience, let's hear what you got! Not bad. Now what do you do if something bad happens in our story today, audience? Ooh, very good. Now can anyone out there guess what this large blue rectangle is in the center of our carpet? I'll give you a hint. It begins with an L and ends with an E. A lake! Yes, this is a lake. But this is not just any old lake. This is the most beautiful lake you've seen in your entire life. And it is filled with crystal clear, pure water. Now, when you drink the water from this lake, it actually makes you feel happy. As you can imagine, all the people of Middle Earth love drinking this lake water. But there is one creature in our story who does not like this lake. And does anyone know who that is? It's that serpent over there. He hates this lake because as long as it's here, one of the good people of Middle Earth will want to drink his poison and become one of his wicked minions like those trolls over there. And unfortunately, that is where our story begins today, when they once upon a time, the serpent was out on his balcony, and he was pacing back and forth, trying to think of a way to make everyone in the kingdom drink his poison. Well, come on out here, serpent. He was pacing back and forth, all the way over here, and he was scratching his head, trying to come up with a plan, when suddenly, a fox struck him like a bolt of lightning. He jumped up and down and said, Trolls, gather around. I think I've got a terribly wicked idea. And so, the serpent and the trolls huddled their heads close together, and the man whispered to each other. Then they let out a wicked laugh. And late that night, when everyone was fast asleep, the serpent and the trolls crept down towards the lake. And when they got there, they crouched down low by the water's edge. Now the serpent, he had two long, sharp fangs, which he slowly stuck out. He bent down over the water and began to squirt it with his poison. Now the lake began to bubble and boil and roil and churn until it was no longer crystal clear, pure lake water, but ugly, dark, polluted water. Well, the serpent and the trolls, they jumped up to their feet. They all clicked their heels together.
I guess they didn't like Dorothy. You know, that was the boss.
But anyway, they did a silly dance all the way back to their dungeons, howling with glee. Go ahead, silly dance, trolls. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a great big boo for being so wicked.
Well, you can also clap for them for that silly dance, though. That was pretty good there. Trolls, not bad.
However, the very next morning, the animals and villagers woke up. They all yawned and stretched and rubbed the sand under their eyes, and of course, they didn't know what had happened the day before, and they went skipping down towards the lake. Well, when they got there, they knelt down by the water's edge. They sunk their hands deep into that cool, refreshing water, and they were just about to drink when suddenly the turtle jumped up. She said, wait, hold on, everyone. Don't drink this water. It smells funny.
Well, everyone put their noses down to the water, and they gave it a good whiff.
And they all pinched their noses and shouted,
Hey, you.
They said, oh, you're right there, turtle. This water smells terrible. Could have poisoned our lake. Well, the butterfly, she jumped up. She said, I know who polluted our water. It was the natural gas drilling companies. But then everyone looked around and realized they weren't in Pennsylvania. They were actually in Middle Earth. And Pikachu, he said, Pika, Pika! Which meant something along the lines of, hey, I think the serpent's poisoned the lake, everyone. And what are we going to do about this now?
Well, they started scratching their heads, trying to come up with a plan.
But suddenly, the little mouse, she had an idea. She said, I know. Why don't we go tell the king about this? He's pretty wise. Perhaps he'll be able to purify our lake. Follow me. I know a shortcut through the forest. And so he began to follow that mouse all the way through Kirkwood Forest. She sometimes didn't know where she was going. Oh, right over here, mouse. Well, they went winding and winding in and out of trees. They had to duck underneath a couple of branches. And they jumped over a little brook. And finally, they made their way to the doors of the king's castle, where they knocked upon them three times. Well, the doors, they slowly open, and who should step out? Well, the tall, the brave, the handsome, the Phillies fan, King Rowan, and all his wounded warriors. Well, everyone bowed down before the king animals and villagers. And he said, oh, you don't need to bow before me. What is it that brings you here to my castle? Well, it was the onion farmer who ran forward. He said, your highness, we have horrible news, for the serpent has poisoned our lake. And when the knights heard this, they raised their swords in the air, and they roared with anger. Very good there. Oh, well, the king said, oh, that's some pretty good roaring there, little knights, but I don't think that's going to help the lake. Well, you know what might help the lake, though? Do you see this horn, yeah? And the king held his horn high in the air. Now, this horn was given to me when I was a wee little prince, and it is said that if I play a tune on it in the hour of greatest need, it'll bring the unicorn down from the mountain, and she'll be able to purify the lake with a mere touch of her horn. And so with that, King Rowan took a great deep breath. He clapped the horn to his lips and began to play his tune. Well, quickly, everyone ran down to the forest to see if they could find the unicorn. Knights, animals, villagers, and all. They looked up high in the sky, thinking that maybe she might be flying like a Pegasus. Then someone shouted under the bushes, and they started looking underneath each and every bush in the forest. They had to crawl through logs. They had to lift up heavy rocks. But soon they looked over their right shoulders, their left shoulders. They were spinning around in circles, trying to look behind themselves. But the unicorn was nowhere. And sadly, they walked back to King Rowan's side. He had stopped playing his music. And the king said, well, everyone, did you find the unicorn? And sadly shook their heads no. Oh, dear. Well, playing my horn might not have caught the unicorn, but, well, what are we going to do, everyone? Well, it was then that the breadstick, the bread maker, the baker, he raised his breadstick in the air and said, I know, your highness, why don't we just go hail the princess? He's on top of the Crystal Mountain about this. They're pretty wise, and I deliver them bread every day, and I'm pretty sure they might have some magic to help us. And the king said, all right, everyone, follow that bread maker. And so they followed the baker up the side of the Crystal Mountain. They had to dig their fingernails and their claws into the sides of the rocks. But you see, the Crystal Mountain goes by another name, and that is the Slippery Mountain. For the higher you climb, the slipperier it gets. And soon everyone was slipping and sliding all over the place. They slid all the way over to the left side of the mountain. And then they slid all the way over to the right side of the mountain. They slowly started slipping back until they were dangling off the edge of a giant cliff. And they all screamed! That day, if it wasn't for the pickle lady. The pickle lady, she raised her pickle and said, by the power of pickle, I see a staircase. Why don't we just take the stairs, everyone? Well, everyone smacked their hands to their forehead and said, oh dear. And so they started walking up that staircase. They had to lift their knees high in the air, for it seemed as if these steps were carved by giants. But the higher they climbed, the thirstier they became. And as you all know, they hadn't had anything to drink in 2 whole days. Well, soon they started to get very tired. Their knees began to wobble, their tongues hung out of their mouths, and one by one they dropped to the ground, unable to go any further. And it looks like this could be the end of our story, ladies and gentlemen, with all the good peoples of Middle Earth lying here, dying of thirst and exhaustion. If it wasn't for that little knight right over there. He refused to let his friends die. He struggled up to his feet with the last bit of life left in him, and he marched up the side of the Crystal Mountain. And when he got there, he knocked upon the princess's palace doors. And the princesses, they opened the doors, they rushed out, and they said, oh, hello there, knight. Have you come to bring us our monthly security report, or are you interested in meeting that hot dog over there? Well, the knight said, good day, everyone, follow me. And so the princesses dashed down the side of the mountain, trying to, well, come on, princesses, we gotta help everybody. They dashed down the side of the mountain, and when they saw everyone lying there, dying of thirst, they knew just what to do. They rushed around and began to gently touch them on their heads with their magic wands. And as soon as everyone's head was touched, their mouth was filled with a great big gulp of fresh mountain spring water. They jumped up to their feet and cheered, hooray for the princesses! Well, come on, audience, let's hear it for the princesses. This is a good part of the story. Now, then, the queen of all the princesses
Queen Nimre, which is this princess over here, she stepped forward to the king, and she said, "Excuse me, Your Highness, why is everyone dying here on the side of my mountain?" The king said, "Terrible news, queen, for you see, the serpent has poisoned our lake." And when the princesses heard this, they put their hands on their cheeks, and they screamed! The queen, she waved her wand and said, "Now, princesses, calm down, calm down. And when I was a wee little princess, the unicorn came to me in a dream and taught me to whistle a tune. And she says if I whistle my tune in the hour of greatest need, she will come galloping down from the mountainside, and surely she'll be able to purify the lake with a mere touch of her horn." And so with that, Queen Imre stood right over here on her palace step. "Come on, queen." And she took a great deep breath. She puckered up her lips, and she began to whistle her most beautiful song. Well, quickly, everyone ran down to the mountainside to look for the unicorn. They ran all the way over to the north side of the mountain. They ran over the way over to the east. They ran to the south. They ran to the west. They went north by northeast, south by southwest. They went north, south, by east, west. Which isn't much of a direction at all, actually. They started jumping up and down, thinking that maybe if they were a bit taller, they could see that unicorn. And finally, they were running around in circles, calling out, "Unicorn! Where are you?" But it was no use. The unicorn was nowhere to be found, and everyone gathered back over to Queen Nimre. Their heads hung low. But the queen did not need to ask, for she already knew they had not found her. She said, "Oh my, this is the worst thing that has ever happened in all of Middle-earth, but there is still one hope left, and that is the unicorn in all her wisdom is down at the lake right now, purifying the water as we speak. And that is where our final destiny awaits us. Follow me, everyone. I will a shortcut through the enchanted forest." And so they followed the queen into a very dark and ancient place. Now the queen reminded her princesses to hold their wands high in the air, and they glowed brighter to lead the way through the murky darkness. Now the enchanted forest is usually a lovely place, but the trees had been drinking the serpent's poison, and now their hearts grew dark and wicked, where they started to lift up their roots to trick everybody, and everyone had to hop and skip over each and every one of those roots. Now when the trees noticed that this wasn't working, they started to lower their branches to bump them on their heads. So everyone had to duck under a branch and jump over a root. And finally, the trees threw prickers down on the ground, and everyone had to carefully tiptoe over each and every pricker so that they wouldn't step on one. But once in a while, they would step on a spike, and it would send them flying 6 feet in the air, crying, "Ouch! Oh, my foot!" Ducking and jumping and walking around in a circle still made everyone tired yet, and they thought they could go no further when finally they burst out of the line of trees and they looked down at their lake, which is now nothing more than a small poison puddle. Well, they were so sad they gathered by the water's edge. They fell down and began to cry on each other's shoulders. Screaming loud songs, everyone. This was the saddest day in all of their lives, but this was the happiest day in the serpent's life. He actually thought this was funny. He stood out on his balcony and said, "Trolls, I'm an evil genius. Why, look, they're all down there at once, and they're too weak to fight. Now all we've got to do is bump their heads in that poison long enough for them to drink, and the kingdom shall be ours." And so, the serpent and the trolls, they crept down towards the lake, and when they got there, they stopped and crouched down by the water's edge. But you see, the serpent and his trolls had made a terrible mistake, for the bushes they were crouching down behind were ragweed bushes, and they started sneezing up a storm. Well, go ahead. Well, this sneezing alerted the king. He jumped up and said, "Hold on, everyone. Hear those bushes over there? Those bushes are sneezing, and bushes don't sneeze. I think that's not a sneezing bush. I think that's an ambush. Quickly, to the other side of the lake." So everyone ran over to the other side of the lake. The queen said, "Princesses, line up shoulder to shoulder right here, and aim your wands at those sneezing bushes." The king said, "All right, knights, now gather round here, gentlemen, and Now I want you to get down on your hands and knees and start crawling towards those bushes, pretend like you're looking for four-leaf clovers, and then, when those bushes least expect, they give them a good pounce. So the knights started crawling towards those bushes. The trolls, they tried to hold in their sneeze, but their lungs felt like they were about to burst. And soon, the trolls and the rest of the audience out there, that's you, alright, they let out their biggest sneeze you've ever heard! It was so powerful it blew the king and the knights over on their backs, with their arms and legs wiggling in the air. Well, the trolls, they jumped out from behind the bush. They raised their swords, ready to attack, when suddenly the princesses raised their wands, and gold lightning shot out at those trolls, making them shrink smaller and smaller and smaller, to look like tiny little ants on the ground. Well, the knights, they looked around kind of confused. They said, princesses, why do you shrink those trolls so small? We can't fight something we cannot see. The princesses wiggled their wands once again, but their magic had gotten out of control, for they were so thirsty. The trolls roared back to life. They were 50 feet tall, and a great battle began! Come on, everyone, you're princesses. You are princesses. You are not to fight with your magic wand. Stay right there. There we go. Well, those knights, they fought through it with all valor and bravery. The villagers, they rushed out onto the battlefield, and they started buffing those trolls with their breadsticks. The pickle farmer, she pummeled them with their pickle, and that beet farmer, she made sure to give the trolls a good beating. The little mouse, she ran forward with Pikachu. She raised him in the air, and lightning shot out those trolls, but it was no use, for the trolls were too tall, too strong, and it was not a critical hit. Well, the trolls knocked the swords out of the hands of the knights. They knocked the food out of the hands of the villagers. The knights fell down upon their knees. They raised their shields high above their heads, preparing for the final blow. The trolls raised their swords, but suddenly the trolls froze. They looked into the knight's shields, and what did they see? But something they had never seen before. Their own reflections. And when the trolls realized how ugly and wicked they'd become, they all screamed! They went running back to their dungeons, where they dove under their beds and cried for their mummies. Well, this made the serpent more malicious than ever. The serpent, he stormed out onto the battlefield, threw down his sword and shield, raised his arms, and blue lightning shot out at all the good peoples of Middle Earth. And serpent, did you forget you're listening ears today? Come on, come on. You're shooting lightning out of your fingertips right now. Throw down your sword and shield. You don't need those for lightning. Go ahead, let them go. Drop them to the ground. There we go. Let's try this again. He shot blue lightning out of his fingertips, instantly hypnotizing everyone in Middle Earth. Their eyes grew wide as saucers, their arms stuck out in front of them, and they began to walk towards the lake, where the serpent had enchanted the poison to look like it was crystal clear water. Well, everyone knelt down by the lakeside, and they were just about to take a drink. But all of a sudden, Queen Nimue, she jumped up to her feet. She said, wait a minute, everyone. I just realized something. I've been whistling my tune wrong this entire time. I remember how it goes now. And she started to whistle like she had never whistled before. Well, everyone threw the poison back into the lake, but the serpent's spell was broken, and this made the serpent even angrier. Well, now, yellow lightning shot from his fingertips, so powerful, it made the lake look like lemonade. Well, no one could resist the lemonade. Their heads bent down closer, their mouths open wide. They were about to drink again, but King Rowan, he jumped up and said, hold on a minute, I just remember how my part of this tune goes. And he began to blast upon his horn. Well, they threw the poison back for a second time. And now the serpent was flaming mad. Red bolts of lightning shot out into the water, making it look like Kool-Aid. The water even shouted, oh yeah! What on earth is the Kool-Aid? Their noses bent down closer and were about to touch the poison. But it was too late for the serpent this time. For as the music drifted into the air, a mysterious wind took it and carried it higher and higher until it reached the highest mountain peak in all of Middle Earth. And there at last, in the hour of greatest need, the unicorn did hear the music. She looked down and saw everyone about to drink the poison. And in a flash, she stood between the serpent and the lake. Now the serpent let forth his greatest power. Black lightning shot from his fingertips, so powerful it jolted the unicorn backwards. Her back hoof was about to touch the poison. She was caught between the lightning and the lake, but she refused to yield any further. The serpent
giant smote her with another mighty bolt, but the unicorn held her ground. And in a rage, the serpent lunged towards the unicorn to push her in, but just as she lowered her horn, and the serpent pierced himself and fell. Well, wearily, the unicorn returned to the lake, and as soon as her horn touched that poison, it began to bubble and churn until it was no longer poison, but crystal clear, pure water once again! The unicorn vanished as quickly as she had arrived. Well, everyone was so happy their lake could return to normal, they began taking great big gulps of the water, and it made them so excited, they jumped up to their feet and spun around in a circle. But while they were enjoying that lake water, the trolls came hobbling out of their dungeons, looking very jealous. Everyone saw those trolls coming, and they screamed! The trolls, they had dropped their swords and shields. They said, wait, hold on, everyone. We don't want to hurt you. We were wondering if maybe we can have some of your water, because it makes you feel happy, right? Everyone nodded their heads yes and said, of course, trolls, why don't you have a drink of water? So the trolls went down to the lake. They each took a great big gulp. And as soon as the magic water washed over their tongues, a transformation began. The trolls peeled back their helmets. They pulled off their black armor and revealed themselves to be the most adorable creatures you ever seen. Why, it looks like a group of Lost Boy Scouts. Well, everyone ran over to them and began giving them great big hugs and high fives. And while they were hugging those trolls, maybe it was too early for a relationship. Well, anyway, the serpent, he came crawling towards the lake with the last bit of life left in him. Everyone saw the serpent. They backed away from the water. They didn't know what he was going to do. He kept crawling and said, this water, does it heal wounds? Stool. And the serpent dove into the lake, body and all, and he began splashing about, making silly noises. Well, the scales melted off of his back, his serpent head fell down into the water, and when he popped out of the lake, he was no longer a serpent, but the most handsome chap you've ever seen! Well, the serpent, he walked over to the king. He was kind of embarrassed. He said, Your Highness, I've done a lot of terrible things in my life, and I was wondering if there's any way I could make it up to you. Well, the king scratched his chin thoughtfully, and then he scratched his head, and he rubbed his belly for a bit. That's how kings think of you. And he said, I know, serpent, you can say you're sorry by teaching us all your silly serpent dance! Show him how there's a silly serpent dance. And whenever he did it with his legs, that's what they did with their legs. And whenever he did it with his arms, that's what they did with their arms. And they were so happy, they danced the silly serpent dance. For how you two villagers, their big party troopers, dance already dance. They danced this way for 3 whole weeks. And finally, at the end of their dancing celebration, they gathered right back here to their lake. They threw their arms high into the sky, and that the biggest cheer you've ever heard! And then they did the strangest